This collection of 8mm movies is the greatest gift that I have to give because it's me when I was young. With my passion for photography and especially for 8mm movies first, no family event was ever properly sanctioned unless I got movies of it. And I did everything with this camera that I bought at Thrifty for $1,888. I did the photography, I directed, I told people what to do, I moved them around, I had them repeat things, I wouldn't let anyone look at the camera, because that totally spoiled it in my opinion. I scripted, I edited, I acted. Every time I showed this clip of me with the film splicing cement and the splicer, Mother commented to people bragging about how organized I am, that I would always cap the bottle before I went on. And I always explained that the only reason I did this is because the film splicing cement is very spillable, I think very evaporative, and very expensive, like 79 cents a bottle. And I think I maybe only replaced the bottle one time. I think it was like twice the amount of cement for the money, because that's how I did things, and that probably lasted me all the 10 years or so, and then I went to tape splices eventually. My first production was Posey's Wedding, 1960, and on the same reel, the following year, 1961, April's Birth. I made a title, which I did as an overlay by backing the film up in the camera, figuring out how far to back it up. It was like a couple of feet to hopefully have this appear on the screen at the right time. And it worked. It totally was pretty accurate. And I made the title on a black piece of probably a fairly large black piece of paper, and I used Elmer's glue to draw out April Lynn Hill, and then I used gold glitter on the Elmer's glue. I spent a lot of time on this. Mother's suggestions, and she helped with that. I did the work, but she had the ideas of using the Elmer's, and then I filmed this and as an overlay. And when Posey saw it, I showed it to her outside of the projector, having her hold the film up to a lamp, and she looked at the lettering and she gasped and said, "That's almost beautiful." And I'm thinking, is that ever a big sisterly thing to say, almost beautiful? Far be it to say it's beautiful, almost beautiful. I had this camera for about a year. I saved my money. I saw this at Thrifty for $1,888. In later years after buying this, I saw this camera, a cheaper version, a plastic version, for $1,488, but I didn't have the ability to get around back in those days, and this was my choice, and this is what they had at Thrifty, and my plan was to buy this for Mother and Dad for their anniversary in 1961. Because I guess I thought I was too young to have a camera of my own or something. I figured I would be taking the pictures, but it would be Mother's and Dad's camera. And I saved my money mowing lawns, and it was about a week before the anniversary, and I had about $13 and needed about $5 or something like that. And so I mowed the lawn, I mowed the weeds and back, because Dad would pay me $5 to do that. But for some reason, he didn't pay me $5, I guess because he didn't tell me to do it. I just did it. And maybe he figured that it, you know, you don't just hire yourself to do a job. And so he only gave me $1, and I can't remember how I earned that money, but I did. And I gave them this camera for their anniversary. And Mother, very predictably, handed it right back to me, said, "You're the photographer, you take the pictures." And she might have said something like, "It'll be present enough to us to have this collection of movies." Something like this is what I would have said in that situation. I don't remember. Anyway, the camera became mine. And the things I did with this camera, that it doesn't even have a variable aperture on the lens. It has click stops for f11, f8, f5.6, down to f2.8, which is not a very big opening, back in those days especially. So I couldn't do the fade-outs by closing down that diaphragm. But I figured out a way to do fade-outs. I used a cardboard and slowly went like this, and then I would back up the film. I would take my camera into my dark room, and I would back up the film a couple of inches for my fades, or maybe as much as a couple of feet for my titles and other overlays, guessing on how far to back it up. And later on, I got a changing bag, a portable darkroom that you put your hands into to do my overlays and my double exposures. And I figured out, I did the math, 16 frames a second, 80 frames per foot. Therefore, 1 second is about a fifth of a foot or a couple inches or so. And that's how far I would back up the film after fading out, and then I'd fade it back in and do my dissolve. I also did this for title overlays, and I did the titling on black background with lettering. And I did some animated titles frame by frame and had the titles move across the screen. You'll see all this, and I did all that with this for about a year.
Thank you.
April's first birthday was my first animation, I believe, the title and the animated title, and I made the doll move. I'm going to show this and also a doll segment that I always liked. I had fun with Mother's Doll Collection. I made these dolls come alive. I'm going to show these two, and then a lot of the movies that I will be showing, you'll see some animations, some time lapse, and things like this that I did manually, frame by frame. The Stormy April movie was made in 1967. It was with the Revere camera. And this has some titling effects and special effects that I was very proud of. I did my this has my doll animated doll movies. Some rather creative stuff, and finishes with a time lapse of the clouds, the stormy part of April. And they are moving, and I was out there out in the front yard shooting across the street, probably this is the view from the kitchen window, and I was probably shot for about an hour or more, or one frame at a time, every 10 seconds, whatever it was, to give this animated effect. And it was done singly. It was nothing, no intervalometer, nothing like that. It was totally, entirely manually done. You've been watching the short subjects, the 50-foot movies, and there's a bunch of them missing. There's a 400-foot reel of 50-foot movies that's probably with a projector someplace that I might have taken out of my collection, and I can't find it. Eventually I will. You're only getting about half of my movies with this collection anyway. There'll be some more coming up later on. Among the missing, some of the really good ones, Gone Again, Annie and Mopsy, Generations of Fools, Easter Picnic, Cox's at Bat, Traditional, Saturday Night Evening, First Day of School, 1961. But now we'll be going on to some 16, 24, and 30-minute movies. Thank you.
busy sidewalk, dressed in holiday style. In the air there's a feeling of Christmas. Children laughing, people passing, meeting smile after smile. And on every street corner you silver bells.
Jolly happy soul, with a corncob pipe and a button nose, and his eyes made out of coal. Frosty the snowman made the children laugh and play. Were they surprised when before their eyes he came to life that day? There must have been some magic in that old silk hat they found. For when they placed it on his head, he began to dance around. Old Frosty the Snowman was alive as he could be. And the children say he could laugh and play just the same as you and me. Hot that day, so he said, let's run and we'll have fun before I melt away. So down to the village with a broomstick in his hand, running here and there all around the square, saying, catch me if you can. He led them down the streets of town right to a traffic cop, and he only paused a moment when he heard him holler, stop. For Frosty the Snowman had to hurry on his way, but he waved goodbye saying,